I'm Julie Philipp, and this is Need to Know Rochester. Joy Parker is a wife and mother, a photographer, and a local blogger. She works as web coordinator right here at WXXI, and she is the winner of the 2011 Robert Ross Muscular Dystrophy Association's Personal Achievement Award in Greater Rochester. That's a lot of words to describe someone whose experience with Lou Gehrig's disease is inspiring many others with and without the disease. Welcome to the program, Joy.
Thank you.
Now, how much did you know about ALS or Lou Gehrig's disease before you were diagnosed with it?
Well, not really too much about it until I started having just strange symptoms that I couldn't figure out what they were for or why they were happening. And it turns out when you do a search on WebMD...
I was going to ask, since you are the web coordinator, you're probably trying to do a lot of web diagnosis, self-diagnosis.
Yeah, there's like 80-some different things that have to do with twitching. But eventually, as I started looking through them, ALS seemed to fit the bill, and I was like, no, I'm just putting that out of my...
Because you went for several years before you were diagnosed, so you sort of suspected for some time. Yeah. You had. Can you describe the symptoms a little more? You said twitching?
Yeah, there was twitching in my legs at first, just weird, just twitching. They thought maybe it was restless leg syndrome. And then as it started to creep up my body, that's when I was like, something's not exactly right here. I was finally getting enough sleep because I had a baby, so finally I was now sleeping through the night and it was still happening. Mm-hmm. So, I was back and forth to the doctor and they didn't really know what it was. I'm not really a candidate in the sense of that it's usually males. They're usually like in their 50s or 60s that have it. So,
of course. So the doctors weren't thinking along the same lines that you sort of were thinking along. Right. So what was it that finally tipped it, that the doctors finally said, you know what, this is Lou Gehrig's disease?
Well, I was having problems with my feet and I went to physical therapy. And I was doing great in physical therapy, except the therapist was like, you should be by this time progressed to this level. I really think you might want to see a neurologist just to check and make sure. So that's what I did.
So what were the problems with your feet that you were going to physical therapy? What did they think you needed physical therapy for?
Well, I had been actually laid out from pneumonia for like a month. And so my feet were a little messed up from not walking around. And so they thought, going to physical therapy, I'd be able to get all my strength back and everything would be fine. But there was still something not right.
Mm-hmm. So describe what Lou Gehrig's disease is.
Lou Gehrig's disease is where your the nerves in your muscles slowly die. Mm-hmm.
So the nerve cells telling your voluntary muscle action is
right.
How I've read it.
Yeah.
Die. And so then your muscles are not moving, become progressively weaker, and that's what you've been experiencing.
Yes, and there are different types of the disease. There's people that starts with the feet and the legs and it slowly goes up. And then there's other people where it starts with their voice and their mouth.
And goes down. And works the other way.
Right.
What is your treatment?
I am currently taking a medication called Rilotec. And what it does is they've learned that your muscles, when you have ALS, make too much glutamate. And that causes the nerves to die quicker. And the Rilotec is kind of like a blocker. It inhibits the glutamate from doing that.
Okay, so that slows it down.
It slows it down, and for people who have the more aggressive version of ALS, it extends their life by about 3 months or so. I have been told that I have the longer form, so it's a more slowly progressing type.
Mm-hmm. And they really don't know for sure what causes this disease. Can they look at you and say, oh, this is why Joy Parker has it?
No, and that's probably one of the more frustrating things. So for people to help get their research money going so they can find out what is causing this amongst all these people all over the world, And then to be able to cure it, I think, is after you find out what the cause is.
Now, at the beginning of the show, I read a quote from your blog that said, you can't let it overwhelm you, or you can let it overwhelm you, or you can take it on. And you weren't directly talking about your disease at the time. You were talking about a photograph that was on your blog that had your young daughter sort of exploring in this great big field. But it really seems to apply with to this situation with how you are handling this disease. You're really taking it on. How difficult is it to kind of maintain that attitude?
I have my days. mostly, though, there's nothing I can do to change the situation. So for me, you know, I just have to live my life. There's really no other choice but to just carry on, go to work, do what I need to do, and raise my kids and, you know, just be who I am. Because the alternative is, you know, to just sit in a corner and cry, and that's just not the kind of person that I am.
That's not you. You are, having known you, I know you're very aptly named. But what are some of the changes you've had to make in your daily life in order to cope with this?
Well, going up and down stairs are extremely difficult. We're getting to the point where I'm going to need a stair lift to get me up the stairs to, you know, go to sleep at night. I have to use a walker now. I did progress to finally a cane. And then I'm like, okay, well, I probably need to be more stable. I'll use a walker. And when I have to go places where it's a long distance to walk to, I use a wheelchair. Mm-hmm. So it is.
You've had to make some changes. What about just simple things, like something you do with your daughters or preparing meals? Or has that changed for you, too?
Yeah, I don't prepare too many meals much anymore. I can have people get me pots and pans and bend down and pick stuff up for me, sit at the stove. Playing with my daughter is probably the worst thing because I can't run after her and, you know, play tag and stuff like I did with her older sister, even.
Mm-hmm. So have you found new ways to interact with her?
Yeah, we spend a lot more time, like, cuddling on the,
that's not a
on
bad
the chair
thing.
And things like that.
How do you talk about this with her, your little one?
She knows that I'm sick. She knows that I can't do things. She accepts it. In the beginning, when she was starting to ask some questions, I just kind of told her that I was sick, and she goes, Mommy, I don't really need to know about that right now. I said, okay, that's fine.
They're very wise, aren't they? Now, what kind of reaction are you getting from other people in your life? What is it you wish people understood about you and the way you're coping with this disease?
I would say that people are often surprised that I'm just so relaxed about it, I guess. Mm-hmm. But like I said, there isn't anything that I can do about it, so I'm not just going to dwell on it. I want to just get out there and do the things that I want to do before I can't do them anymore, basically.
But in addition to doing that, you're becoming somewhat of an advocacy for treatment, cures, that sort of thing. You won this award, the Personal Achievement Award from the Muscular Dystrophy Association. What did that mean to you?
Well, I guess I didn't realize that I was different in how I was accepting all of this news. You know, I didn't realize that I had such a great positive attitude about the fact that I have this disease. So it was kind of a surprise that people wanted me to do it, in a sense, because I'm just living my life. I'm just doing what it is I need to do.
And what this award, I don't know if it's just this award, but you're doing speaking engagements, appearances. You've taken on a new role. What are some of the things that you're up to these days?
Well, this week I will be speaking at the ALS Gala that they do for ALS awareness. It's a research fundraiser for ALS specifically through the MDA. And I will be speaking to a bunch of people, about, you know, my experiences and how the MDA helps me and how, you know, we do need money for research.
Have you studied that? Have you looked into, is there a real lack of funding for this kind of research compared to other diseases, or is this just an ongoing effort to keep the money there?
Well, I think people are not, because ALS really is a rare disease, people are not thinking about those types of diseases. They're thinking about cancer and AIDS, the big ones, and that's where a lot of the money ends up going, and that's great because those need attention as well. But when you get down to some of the more rare types of things, that's when you kind of need to
step it up.
Yeah, and let them know that, hey, there's these other things that are really just horrible and you need your help.
Well, thank you so much for taking the time to do that, Joy
you
Parker.
Bet.
Joy is helping spread awareness of ALS, more commonly known as Lou Gehrig's disease.